Wars. Nothing but Star Wars. Give me those Star Wars. Don't let them end.
Bienvenidos, worldwide fans of our planet's hottest entertainment with an edge from a galaxy far, far away. I mean Fuego here once again and welcoming you to my namesake program in Fuego. Entertainment. Just call me Fuego for short. And yes, I'm stoked to be talking about more of these comics that take place between the prequels and the original trilogy. Yes, so between episodes 3 and 4, there's a lot that was going down in our beloved galaxy far, far away. And I just filmed a review of Han Solo Imperial Cadet. And so next up, I have the corresponding book, which is Lando Double or Nothing, if you can actually see that without the glare of my lighting system here. But so to correspond with the release of Solo: A Star Wars Story, which was the second spin-off film that regrettably was nowhere near as successful as I would imagine that they would have hoped, especially with the iconic nature of the character, but also having a brilliant recasting of Lando with none other than the Childish Glover, Donald Gambino, whatever he calls himself. But talented dude, he's funny, great musician, and songwriter and everything like that. I mean, a man of many talents, obviously. And so that was actually where, the casting of Han was very questionable. Dude from Hail Caesar, the Coen Brothers movie, nobody really knew him from anything beyond that. But yet, Donald Glover came with a notoriety, you know, from both his music as Childish Gambino and, you know, with his work on Community and Atlanta and, I mean, various other things. I don't know if he had been doing Atlanta when this film came up. But nonetheless, I mean, he already had a very prestigious reputation and just list of projects behind him. And so he was the big name in this movie when this all came together. And that was actually, if we're going to do a young Lando Calrissian, you know, I was all for that casting. I actually thought, you know, it was personally pretty dope in my estimation. So I was about it. And he's good in it. He is. He's very solid in the film. And he has funny interplay with this L337? I want to say the name of the droid is. I'm trying to remember. Yes, L337. But he just calls her L3 for short, basically. And that was one of the more amusing aspects of the film for me, was just the personality of that female droid of his and just their banter back and forth and their almost like playful flirting, smack talking of sorts. And it was something that people overanalyzed immensely in reviews of the film. It's like, wow, is this droid like in love with Lando? Did they have like some weird thing going on? I don't know, think what you will, but this takes place before that. And actually, Double or Nothing leads right up to Han's meeting him in the Solo: A Star Wars Story film. And so I will go on record once again, yeah, as I did in the previous review, to say I did not like Solo: A Star Wars Story very much upon my first theatrical sit down with it. There was some, you know, cool Easter eggs, and I liked Glover's performance and stuff, and I didn't mind our Solo, but I mean, I don't know, there was just, and I liked Woody Harrelson too. I mean, and this is the thing, you can tell that upon repeated viewings, I actually grew to really appreciate this film a lot more than I was expecting. And so, of course, I had to do reviews in my continued chronological canon coverage. Yeah, super fragilistic XBL or whatever. Yeah, there's your tongue twister, everybody. So in my continuing canon chronicle coverage, whatever, I had to at least cover these comic books. And this one, it's kind of forgettable, but it's still fun in that regard. So, I mean, we meet up with Lando, and he's just going back and forth with L3 and talking about how he needs to deck out the Millennium Falcon and turn it into almost like a little mini casino of sorts. He wants a wet bar, he wants all these different things, and of course she's like, well, you need to upgrade these defenses and these, you know, weapons and blah, blah, blah. You basically need to make sure the Falcon, you know, despite being super fast, is actually formidable and able to defend itself in any instance of some shizzle going down. And shizzle goes down in this particular book because a woman named Christus, she basically comes to him, and her home planet of Khol Groon has been taken over by the Imperials. And they're basically using it as like a droid disposal place of sorts. And so all of those droids, those battle droids from the Clone Wars, that a lot of them are still probably just sitting around, and, you know, they were all decommissioned after Order 66 went into place and the Clone Wars ended. And, you know, they switched over from Galactic Republic to Imperial Empire. And so, yeah, they like they're decommissioning them and they're being brought to this planet that has been taken over by the Imperials. And so Christus' father is being held hostage there, and basically Christus has brought on Lando to try to help with the infiltration and possible liberation of her people. And he's like, okay, well, that's all well and good, but you gotta pay me. And, you know, he's like, credits, 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 baby. And he is written, he's got the swagger and the arrogance in Solo: A Star Wars Film, but I feel like they definitely cranked it up a significant notch in this comic book. It's amusing to a point. It gets a little excessive when he's having just banter by himself as he's running around this planet, going through their weird wasteland areas, encountering other, like, smuggler ill fools that he has, like, mucked over the years and stuff like that. So, very much like Han. You can tell why Lando and Han became kindred spirits because of the fact that, yeah, they're both kind of these, you know, just swaggery, shady to a degree kind of guys that do have good hearts, but yet they also have some rough edges to them, and they are very full of themselves and the arrogance and everything. But, you know, when he's just running around the planet and he's just constantly talking about the greatness that he exudes, it was almost reminding me of, like, those old shoot interviews that The Rock was doing back when he was in WWE, just constantly oozing of this machismo and just over-the-top silliness of greatness. And yeah, you get it in spades in this book, whether it's him going back and forth with L3, whether it's him doing his audio logs, you know, which are called the Calrissian Chronicles, which are amusing, and it's him just waxing philosophically about life, the nature of it, his outlook, his mentalities, all these different things. But as you would expect, he shows himself to be a hero when the chips are down. I mean, so there is a major essence of predictability about this book, and it really, at the end of the day, the most entertaining stuff is the back and forth between him and L3, and you see the first sown seeds of the fact that, you know, L wants to really just rise up against, you know, just the imposing power of the Empire and how they have mistreated her droids as well, her fellow droids, you know? And we definitely get some flavor of that in Solo. It was done a little more over the top in Solo. Actually, when she joins these reprogrammed droids on this planet that they're trying to liberate and everything, I bought it a little bit more in this, where she joins up and takes arms with them against these stormtroopers. I enjoyed that a lot more than how, like, it came off a lot cheesier in the Ron Howard movie, I gotta say. So, yes, you can tell that, yeah, there is that just inclination for her and that deep felt conviction, and so that's a plot point. And as I said, you know, that Lando tries to rally these people in his own unique way, and yeah, I mean, it's a fun little book if you're somebody who isn't as interested in this particular era between the prequels and the original trilogy, and also if you weren't that big of a fan of the Star Wars, that Solo spinoff film, you probably won't be that into this. It's rather forgettable in that regard, but as a canon completist that I'm attempting to be, at least as far as, like, the new Disney canon since they purchased Lucasfilm, this was essential reading for me because it does add a few interesting little details about Lando's young character, about, you know, his relationship with L3, obviously. That's much more just built upon and defined here and distinguished, and more of what you'd seen before, but just in a much more playful and interesting manner and stuff like that. So, I don't know, I really enjoyed Lando Double or Nothing. There is, a Billy Dee Williams, Lando comic that they did later on that takes place in the original trilogy's continuity and stuff. But, I just love this, you know, between 3 and 4 period of Star Wars so much, and all the stuff that was going on in the galaxy at the time, that, this, at least for me, was something that I did enjoy quite a bit. And the art is fantastic. I have to at least give a shout out in that, because I was trying to give the technicals out. So the art was done by Paolo Vianelli, and then the color artist, the person actually the colorist, was Andres Mosa, and then the writing was done by Rodney Barnes. And Rodney Barnes, obviously, was took the ball running and had some fun with this, and just making the Lando character maybe even a little more deplorable and, like, over the top ridiculous than in previous incarnations that we'd seen, including in Solo, with Childish Glover's performance. So, in any event, guys, that is going to do it for today. Gracias, a grande one. In fact, I've been Jaime Infuego, and y'all can find me on all social media sectors, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, YouTubes. Those are the four destinations I frequent, just like you see spelled below. Here on Infuegotainment, it's primarily nerdtastic stuff, like tons of Star Wars coverage of the comic, the novel, and the film variety. I just rewatched and reviewed both Ewoks movies. Yeah, that's the dedication that I have to this galaxy far, far away. But even beyond that, I do lots of coverage of superhero stuff back when we had things in theaters, which, oof, boy, who knows when that's gonna be starting back up again. But also indie art house drama stuff. I do some comedies here and there. I have an Animated Monday segment where I spotlight more adult-themed animation, like stuff that's a little more thought-provoking and not like the kiddie Disney type stuff that most people often think of when they hear the word animation and cartoons and stuff like that. So yeah, those are just a few things that I do here on this channel. Less than 30 subscribers from hitting the GZ mark, the 1,000, which is where, just if you were uninformed, that's where a lot of new possibilities for both monetization and creative, just, I don't know, cool new things that you can do with YouTube are basically at your disposal once you pass that threshold. Passed that threshold years and years ago on my other main channel, which is The Horror Show Channel, youtube.com/The Horror Show Channel, just like you see below. That's where we have like 33,000 subscribers compared to my little side channel that I didn't do anything with for a few years and relaunched in 2019. So it's a little bit of an uphill battle here, but there it's on the cool cruise control, and not even so much that, because we still stay vigilant with at least an episode a day, sometimes two, whether it's a review of a film, a television series, a novel, a comic book, video games, including Let's Plays of video games, which Cecil and Andrew Mercer are big into over there. Also, shout out to our girls when they get the chance to jump on, Susie Von Slaughter, Marsha Parker, also, you know, Tomies that have become more involved, like Robert Duell, occasionally Luis Hernandez. And yeah, man, I mean, we try to keep the content as fresh as possible, including also unboxings and, you know, makeup tutorials. We've done comedy sketches. There's lots of fun stuff over there. But yes, regardless of whether you're here with me on Infuegotainment or you jump over there, like, share, subscribe, show some love. Much appreciated. And until the Reel of Caw comes around once more, if you get that reference, I've been Fuego. Y'all have been Rad Status. And yes, looking forward to more palaver sooner rather than later about our beloved Star Wars universe. So, until then, you know the drill. May the Force be with you.